recent trial we've been covering. Michael Dunn convicted of attempted murder, but the jury deadlocked over the question of whether he murdered 17-year-old Jordan Davis. Jordan's parents are here live to speak with Robin. First, ABC's Ryan Owens brings us the juror's story.
I believed he was guilty.
But the first juror in the Michael Dunn case to speak out says not everyone in the jury room agreed.
We pretty much knew after about 2 days with the whole self-defense thing that we were going to be hung.
In an exclusive interview with ABC News, juror number 4 says three members of the jury believed the story of self-defense Dunn told from the stand.
He's showing me a gun and he's threatening me.
In the end, she says the split was 9-3, with most believing the 47-year-old software developer should be held accountable for the death of 17-year-old Jordan Davis.
No life was taken. I mean, there is no longer a Jordan Davis, and there's only one reason why that is.
As to count one, I would declare that mistried.
That hung jury meant a mistrial on the murder count. The state's attorney is vowing to retry Dunn on that. The teen's mourning mom also promising to keep up the fight.
We will continue to stand, and we will continue to wait for justice for Jordan.
The jury did convict Dunn on 3 counts of attempted murder for firing at the 3 other boys in the car that night, 1.5 years ago outside a Jacksonville gas station after an argument over loud music.
We all agreed that there was an imminent threat to these young men that were in the car.
Under Florida law, Dunn will spend the next 60 years behind bars.
Nothing will bring back their son. Nothing. I am sorry, of course. I hope that they feel that we didn't do them a disservice.
For Good Morning America, Ryan Owens, ABC News, Jacksonville, Florida.
And joining us now, Jordan Davis's mother and father, Lucia McBath and Ron Davis, along with their attorney, John Phillips. Good morning to you all.
Good morning.
Good to have you here. I hope that you know that you remain in the thoughts and prayers of many around the world.
Thank you.
You were riveted listening to the juror. I was watching you, watching her, and all the words that she said, especially at the end, saying that they hope that they didn't do you a disservice. Mm-hmm. Your thoughts on what the juror said?
We know that the jurors, when they walked in that room to deliberate, we know without a doubt that they were posed with a very delicate but a very profound decision that they had to make. And we believe absolutely with all of our hearts that they did everything that they could to come to what they believe was the most just decision. We do now know that they were torn. But they've done the best that they can with the tools that they had at that time. And of course, each one of them believes what they believe. And so that's what we have to stand on.
And she was very forthright in saying, this juror, this particular juror, she said that there were 3 who believed that it was self-defense. Mm-hmm. There are many in the country who are wondering how someone could come to that conclusion.
Well, in Florida, you know, you have the stand your ground instruction. Even though the defense, they don't actually file for stand your ground, it's in the instruction for self-defense, and that confuses juries. You know, these people are torn because of the jury instruction, I believe, and not the case. I believe the facts to everybody in the world show that this guy had indifference toward my son and just killed him and continued to shoot at the boys in the car. And so being that they found him guilty on attempted murder 3 times,
exactly,
each count, they knew that's what he did, but the jury instruction on the stand your ground part is very confusing. So I do think she did the best she could as a juror, but I think that those laws have to be rewritten, and I'm going to be one that's going to continue to fight to have stand your ground laws rewritten.
I know that you both will do that. I know you've been, Mr. Phillips, very vocal on that, and I want to ask you about the state attorney who has come under fire for the way the case was presented. Would you have done anything differently? Should anything have been done differently in the state's case?
It was a well-presented case. They did a good job. But we're in a situation in America where the young black boy doesn't get the benefit of the doubt. People can still lock their doors when they walk by, and it's okay. And the white businessman gets the benefit of the doubt. And so when you have a situation where the white businessman is the guy that does wrong, and the African-American boy was amazingly raised by these wonderful parents. They needed to put in a little bit more character evidence, and I realize it's a dicey situation.
And that's an excellent point, because a lot of people were like, why aren't they talking more about your son? So you tell us about your son.
Oh, and I think we've spent a lot of time letting the country know who Jordan was. Jordan was just, as people say, the life of the party. He had a wonderful sense of humor, just very intuitive, very wise, and a very compassionate child. Very sensitive. He was very much in tune to people's feelings around you. He was very inclusive, always wanted to include everyone. It didn't matter in the neighborhood if you had the skinny leg jean child or if you had the nerd or the jock. Jordan wanted to include everyone.
People are listening to you, Lucia, and to you, Ron, and what we saw Saturday after the verdict. Your grace, your composure then and now, and there are many that are saying, we know that you are in immense pain. How are you both able to be as you are right now?
Because you know you already have justice. People don't realize that the justice in the court system is not the ultimate justice. God gives you justice, you know? And when people have indifference to life, we know how people fight so hard to live. I know your story, that you fought very hard to live. And just think about how a person like Michael Dunn would be so callous as to just disregard the life of Jordan Davis. You know, just throw it away like it was nothing. You didn't do what I told you to do, I'm gonna shoot you, you know? And so I tell people out there, God is the ultimate justice. And so justice on earth is one justice, but always look to God to be the ultimate justice.
A lot of people were touched when you said that you were praying for Michael Dunn and having your family to do that as well. Mr. Phillips, you brought up white, black. It's the big elephant in the room. You all have been very certain about not making this about race. And the juror we heard from also, she said a lot that you didn't see. She said that was not a factor in the deliberations. Do you believe that they were colorblind?
Again, it goes to the benefit of the doubt. And you're not going to give the what if Jordan had a gun still comes down. And that's the issue. People still believe that about Jordan because they didn't know Jordan. They didn't see Jordan like I've seen Jordan. And that's the difference. And until we can level the playing field truly, the scales of justice are going to be tipped.
I will allow you both to have the final word here. You have said, you said on Saturday, and we've heard you again and again, you want justice for your son. What is justice for Jordan Davis?
Justice for Jordan will be ultimately really when we change the laws, because that will be not just justice for Jordan and justice for Trayvon and justice for all the children at Sandy Hook and justice for Aurora and justice for Virginia Tech and the Navy Yard. It will be justice for everyone that has suffered because of these laws and will continue to suffer. So once the laws are changed, that's the ultimate justice for all.
And for me, I'm in constant contact with Tracy Martin, Trayvon's father, and I text Sabrina all the time, and I just want to let them know that every time I get justice for Jordan, it's going to be justice for Trayvon, for us, and that the ultimate justice for me. I want Michael Dunn to be tried and found guilty of killing my son, of letting him know that it was wrong to kill my unarmed 17-year-old, you know, and all the other 17-year-olds out there. They shouldn't have to fear the adults with the guns that are running around here shooting them at will. If you throw popcorn in someone's face, they want to shoot you because you threw popcorn in their face. That's what we've come to. And we have to stop.
We have to come together as a nation and have a real dialogue about that.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Thank you both.
Thank you
very, very much.
Mr.
Phillips, appreciate it.
My pleasure.
We continue to lift you up.
Thank you.
Let's get outside now to Ginger and the weather.